welcome each and every one of you this morning to this celebration of life. And I know that it is very easy for us to look at life in various ways, but I truly believe that this is a celebration where we can know that God walks before us and God has perfected a plan that is beneficial to each and every one of us. So before we begin, let us all bow our heads in prayer. Father, we come before you this morning, Father, asking for, Father, Lord, your strength. For it is a difficult morning, a morning, Father, where our minds and our hearts go to an understanding that we no longer, Father, have the opportunity of having Anthony among us. But Father, knowing that you have prepared, Father, the way for him as you will prepare the way for us. So this morning, uplift us all. Allow us all this morning, Father, Lord, to receive hope, to receive encouragement for the things that are going to be shared this morning. And allow us this morning to know that you are the great I am and the one who watches over us, who will not leave us nor desert us, but will walk through life until we enter into your presence. Bless the family and bless these friends. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Anthony Lewis Hudgins, age 40, of Roanoke, went home to be with the Lord unexpectedly on Friday, February the 14th, 2020. He joins his beloved grandfather, Eugene Gear. He was born in Tempe, Arizona, and was the beloved son of Teresa Gear of Roanoke and Tony Hudgins of Roanoke, and his stepmother, Patricia Hudgins of Roanoke. Anthony was an electrician and a carpenter who took great pride in the work that he was called to do. He loved his family, he loved hiking, he loved fishing, and last of all, he loved his cats. In addition to his parents, he is survived by his precious children, Maria Hudgins and Eva Hess, stepchildren Alyssa Hash and Christopher Hash, grandparents Ethelenia and Gordon Hudgins. And I apologize if I can't say your names correctly. I'm sure that Anthony could. But they are of Blue Ridge, grandmother Shirley Gear of Arizona, a sister Shannon Bozeman of Roanoke, and her husband Mike Bozeman, brothers Justin Higgins and his fiancée Sasha Howe of Roanoke, and Brandon Higgins of Roanoke, and nephews Chase Woolwine and Jace Higgins and Derek Hudgins, aunts and uncles Diane and Larry Marshall, Shannon and Tom Bryce, Gianna and Todd Jones, Michelle and Dean Davis, Laurie and Pete McKnight, and Kevin and Vicky Hudgins, multiple cousins and many, many friends. He also leaves a boss that never gave up on him, Zach Hill, and a very special friend, Sarah Satchko, and her children. Anthony, we will carry you in our hearts forever, and we will love you and miss you always. Listen to this song, Broken Halos.
Sing my share of broken halos, folding wings that used to fly. They've all gone wherever they go, broken halos that used to shine. Angels come Jesus, why? When I meant to know the answers, they belong to the by and by.
I want to look back to the obituary, to a statement that was written by his family, describing and allowing us to know who Anthony was. He loved his family. He liked hiking, fishing. And I want to center on that right now. He loved his parents. You know, one of the things about Anthony is that sometimes in life we have difficulty expressing ourselves, but Anthony did love his parents. He had a deep love for them, and he cared about their well-being and their life and what was going on. He also loved his brothers and sisters. You know, I didn't realize that Shannon, she looked so young, that she was the oldest of the two. Until I saw the picture, and I looked, and of course they're much younger there in the picture, but you can see it from that moment on, how she received Anthony, that was her little brother, and you could see, and I can understand how he looked at her. Knew Anthony as an adult, not as a teenager or as a child, but I knew him as an adult. And if there was one thing that he could always count on, it was big sister. And I think sometimes we have a tendency not to realize that we don't look at them as a sister, but sometimes as a second mom. An individual that truly understood who he was. An individual that was never critical of who he was, but just loved him to death. And I think Anthony knew that. And Anthony had this love for her, knowing that he could always count on her. She was always going to be there. Sort of the same blessing that the rest of us have with those of us who have older brothers or older sisters. They become second parents. And that's exactly the way their relationship was. She was always there for him. He loved his children, and you can see that by the photos after photos that are reflected on the screen if you saw them last night or before you came in this morning. He loved them to death. I had an opportunity at times to be in his home and see his kids and how they just were drawn to him. You know, you could tell the character that he had. The characteristics of one who knew how to share of himself and truly who he was and what he wanted to be. Even though he had difficulties in life, it did not hamper the relationships that he established with his family and his children. Yes, he also loved his friends. Speaking to someone, and we were talking about last night during the viewing, and I remarked to them I couldn't find a place to park. I had to go cleaning around the building because of so many that were here. At the time, I thought maybe there was more than one viewing going on until I came in and realized there was only one viewing, a viewing that was being held on his behalf. And the number of friends and family that were here to allow him to know that they were willing to walk that last mile of the way, They were willing to come and bring comfort to you, his family, to come and to share the times that they enjoyed together. I can see why he loved some of the activities that he did, because many of you, his friends, were there with him, sharing in what he enjoyed out of life. I looked and saw photos of him being down at the lake, not only with family, but with friends. He loved to fish. He loved the outdoors. Seeing some of those photos of him on various mountain ranges, and there's one in particular, I see him, and you could see the entire valley behind him. He loved that. He loved that high place, those places that reminded him of God's creative hand, and he drew from those things. And it gave him a way of escape. You know, so often we don't realize that the things we love simply because it gives us an avenue of escape, an avenue to be able to go somewhere where it's quiet, somewhere where it's peaceful, somewhere where nothing's been tainted by the things that men often do to God's creation. He loved that. He loved having that moment of serenity between him and maybe even God. Yes, he loved all those things, and he also loved his animals. I think if there was something that captured his life or our relationship with Anthony, I think it'd be found in this simple poem that simply says, "Until we will meet again." Those special memories of you will always bring a smile. If only I could have you back for just a little while. Then we could sit and talk again, just like we used to do. You always meant so very much, and always will too. The fact that you're no longer here will always cause me pain, but you're forever in my heart until we meet again. You know, I like that. I like the fact that one day we shall see each other again. You know, it's kind of ironic, or maybe not ironic or a coincidence, but I happened to be doing some research, and this poem came up. And immediately it reminded me of what we're here for today, wishing that we could have that one moment to speak to him again, having that one moment to be able to maybe hug him again, to be able to say something of encouragement to him. But even though we don't have that moment, and even though we don't have that opportunity, don't lose hope. Don't lose the opportunity that one day we'll have, for one day we shall see him again and be reunited away from all the things that he wanted to escape. So listen to this song, "When I Get to Where I'm Going."
When I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane, or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. Gonna walk with my granddaddy match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will share the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer, so much work to do. But when I get where I'm going and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, oh, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. Hallelujah. I will love and have no
Now, let me just say and share with you that that first song was very appropriate, Broken Halos. So often we don't realize that we are on a journey. People often ask themselves, you know, why am I here? What is the purpose of my life? And the purpose of your life is to find your way to God, to find your way to what God has in store for you. And in this life, we're going to find ourselves facing those broken halos. And Anthony, even though we have some great photos and pictures to demonstrate, there were moments and times in his life where he was blessed. He was happy. He was fulfilled. But as someone once told me here last night, his life had many ups and many downs. And some of you are familiar with the downs. You're familiar with the struggles. You're familiar with the attacks of the enemy. So even though this journey that we're on is supposed to be a journey to God, there's an adversary that stands in the way and wants to destroy our lives. That's what the Word tells us. He wants to steal what God is trying to give you. He's trying to destroy the very fabric of your life and your existence. And he wants to bring you to death, a spiritual death. The death that we are here for today is not a spiritual death. It is an opportunity to enter into the presence of God himself for our journey to finally come to its end and to its new beginning. So when I began to realize the things that he toiled with and the things that sometimes were difficult for him, let's don't be quick to judge. Let's don't be quick to criticize. For the Word tells us that we've all been in that situation. We've all had struggles. We all have weaknesses. We all have moments when we stumble. But it is so good to know that God has given us friends. God has given us family. God has given us opportunities to discover his compassion for us. And there were times in his life that he understood that those compassions. He understood that there were those who were there to pick him up and them there to help him along life's way. So that it brings me to a point and place that I've always believed in. And that is that we can find ourselves in God's Word somewhere. In God's Word, God reveals a story or a situation where someone just like us found themselves in need, found themselves in a difficult time. That I was reminded of something that I once read. For we also not only find ourselves in God's Word, but God's Word is always has a way of allowing us to see ourselves and to see the struggle, to see what it is that we're going through. And in some way, he reflects it back to us. He speaks about our giving, or he'll speak about our suffering, or even about our journey into his kingdom. That's why when I heard this second song, it brought hope to me. When I get to where I'm going, he has now arrived. He has now been able to accomplish his journey. Now, granted, his journey was one that so often we're not prepared for. We're never prepared for our children to be called away from us into God's presence, or our grandchildren. That's not the way it works, or it's not the way it's supposed to work. We're all supposed to have long lives, but you know what? God, who knows all things, knew when it was time for Anthony to come home. And he demonstrated a compassion that is revealed in his word in a familiar story. And the story kind of goes like this. For Jesus is telling the story of a man who fell into a certain situation and there was no one there to help him. So Jesus then simply said, "Who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor?" And when I began to look at Anthony's life, I began to realize that there were many neighbors in his life, that God had orchestrated many individuals to come into his path or into those moments that were the down moments. Moments when it seemed like all hope was lost, moments of struggle, moments of difficulty. God orchestrated a plan to demonstrate to him his compassion. And in doing so, Jesus told about two individuals who came by, and neither one took the time to render any help to the man in need. It wasn't until a certain man who happened to see the man there in his pain that stopped and gave him what he had. The scripture reveals it like this: "But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on him oil and wine, and he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him." And this is the one thing that I believe that Anthony witnessed in his life. He witnessed a lot of compassion. He witnessed a lot of neighbors. Many of you are sitting here. Many of you that took him up before God in prayer. Many of you who were there when he was caught up in the midst of the struggle. Many of you that lifted him up when he needed a friend and needed someone to comfort him. Someone who was always at the right place and at the right time. When I was speaking to someone last night, I was wondering about his journey until the individual shared with me that just a week ago, he had been in the house of God. Some young lady had invited him, and he went with her into the house of God. What took place in the midst of that service or in the midst of that conversation between him and God, I do not know. But what I do know is that God has compassion, that God wanted to make sure, for God knew what that week was going to hold in his life. Just like God knows you, and God knows your journey, and God knows what's going to take place. I know so often we think that we're going to live forever, but we're reminded of what in God's word, where it simply says in the book of James that life is but a vapor. We're here today and we're gone tomorrow. We've got to make sure that we discover the compassion that God has for us. We got to make sure that we prepare ourselves for that moment in time that God has designated to bring us home into his presence. And when I began to realize that the compassion of God goes so far, it begins to allow me to feel comforted, knowing that God extended himself again into Anthony's life, and to be able to simply say, when I get to where I'm going, I believe Anthony was able to realize that. Realize that this life, who sometimes had so many challenges, is no longer in existence. For now, I am in the presence of the Almighty God, the one who had compassion for me. So much compassion that he gave his own son for my forgiveness. I believe he discovered that last Friday. And what an appropriate day. On a day that is designed for love, I believe he found the love of God. He found what he had been searching for. He found what 1 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us. For eye has not seen nor ear heard the things that God has prepared for us who love him. I believe that today is a day of love. Today is a day that we ought to celebrate the understanding that we can have the love of God each and every day of our lives, whether we're up or whether we're down. God is able to lift us up if we'll just simply invite him into our lives. Yes, listen to this song that I believe reflects his life. It reflects this moment that he is in. Go rest high on that mountain.
Gathered round your grave to grieve, wish I could see the angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high
So in closing, I think we need to do what I believe that Anthony would want us to do. And that is that we should love our neighbor as ourselves. Because you never know when you're going to be a blessing to someone. You never know when you're going to encourage someone. You never know when you're going to be the helping hand that someone needs. Last night, I met an individual that knew me from many years ago who I didn't know whether she was related or part of the family. When she told me no, I just met him just this one time. She was well up in years, and she said my daughter knew him. But I had a difficulty in my life. I had a time when I needed some assistance. I needed someone to be able to build for me something to help me be able to get around. That all of a sudden, one day, he came to my house, and he built that for me. And he said, you know, I realized then what a special young man he was. So kind to come and help someone that he did not know. So he's not asking you to do something that he did not do himself. He became a good neighbor, as many of you became to him. Let us pray. Father, we're thankful this morning for the life of Anthony and what it represented. Father, for the love that he contained in himself, that he shared with family and with his children and his friends. Father, this morning we simply ask that you would allow his life to impact our lives, to allow us to know that even though we might have, Father, Lord, difficult times and moments, that we can still overcome. We can overcome them, Father, when we turned ourselves to you. So, Father, today, bless them and encourage them and help them along their life's way. Give them, Father, Lord, the strength and the courage, Father, to walk each and every day, Father, trying to be who you'd want them to be. Bless us today. Lead us and guide us and comfort our grief. Comfort our souls this morning. And we ask it all in the name of your Son. Amen. The conclusion of this celebration will be held at Mountain View Cemetery.
Last night I had a crazy dream. Wish was granted just for me. It could be for anything. I didn't ask for money or a mansion in Malibu. I simply wished for one more day with you. One more day. Sunset, maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. Leave me wishing still for one more day with you. First thing I do is pray for time to crawl. I'd unplug the telephone, keep the TV off. I'd hold you every second, say a million I love yous. That's what I'd do with one more day with you. One more day. Sunset, maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. sunset, maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. Leave me wishing still one more day. Leave me wishing still one more day. Day with you.